she's bon,
elle est pas
she's,
thérapeute.
She's not a therapist.
Amanda Alarja,
Amanda Alarja, who is a psychologist.
C'est difficile à dire en français,
and
mais c'est comme
therapist.
Ça. Chercheuse de paix.
And voilà. She is a researcher in peace.
On peut les applaudir. Et je vais demander
give them an applause.
À Laura. Drôme,
I would like to ask Laura Drôme, who is co-editor of the newspaper Le Courrier, to moderate this discussion and to discuss with them and
Laura
to give
Drôme.
The floor to the public. Laura, the floor is yours.
Oui. Et juste avant, nous avons
and
un clip.
Just before,
demander le clip.
We'll have a short film.
Asseyez-vous.
שאם רוצים לדיבור, אז תבקשו גברים. אם רוצים לעשות, אז תבקשו נשים.
אני מייצגת 35,000 נשים של נשים עושות שלום.
פנימה בתוך החנות נעמד נער פלסטיני בכניסה, והוא בהתחלה הוא רק הפיל אותי לרצפה, אחר כך הוא הצליח לדקור אותי בכתף ימין. והוא עשה לי חור בריאה, נשברה לי השכם, והוא עשה לי חור בריאה. הייתה בבטן שלי, הייתי בחודש רביעי. אז ברוך השם ניצלתי מהאכזריות והשנאה שראיתי לו בעיניים. גם ראיתי גם פחד, ולראות מה הדברים שאני, מיכל הקטנה, יכולה לעשות כדי לשנות את המציאות הזאת.
From pain. We all, as Palestinians, collectively speaking, come from pain. So the way we approach the world with our pain should not be the same. I hate to be a victim. I don't want to be a victim, and I don't want to use the mentality of victimhood when I speak to the people, because I am a free, liberated woman.
It's time to believe in the people of Palestine and Israel and their desire for a better future. It's time to listen to women.
Yeah.
together, peace is possible.
Peace is possible.
Give women a chance.
Merci beaucoup. Alors, merci beaucoup. Bonjour à toutes
Thank
et à tous.
Thank you very much. Hello everybody. I wish you a warm welcome to on this stage to our two guests. We decided to speak only one language on this stage in English, so that our two guests are on the equal playing level. My English is half-half, but you have the simultaneous translation, so I hope that this debate is going to be understood by everybody. So we are lucky to receive two representatives of the women movements for peace. Is an Israeli, Amanda Alarja, who is a therapist, psychologist. She comes from Bethlehem and she is working with traumatized people. And then we have Angela Yantian, Israeli activist. She's active in the area of the right of the refugees, and she is very committed into this movement. Thank you to both of you for being here. Two women who refuse to live without acting in a violent environment where the violations are happening every day. In this conflict, you are going to be much more able than I to speak about the different things of the two sides after all these attempts to solve the conflict. You have been the witness to the suffering of your fathers, of your neighbors, of everybody around you, and you have these marches for peace. You have been marching going next to the house of Netanyahu, asking the politicians to take their responsibility to find an issue which would be fair and to this conflict. So you are here to explain what the Israeli and Palestinian women can bring to such a conflict which is becoming more and more difficult, where no political solution is working for over 70 years, and this is a very strong symbol to have you here. Amanda Alarja and Angela Yantian, thank you for being here. We are going to speak for a bit less than an hour, and our debate will end just before 5 o'clock, and we'll have a time also for questions and answers. But now I would like to ask
voices. Just before, we also heard Julia speaking about women who are targeted, who are silenced since years, and nowadays you're here to represent women who speak out and who go for peace. In a few words, maybe you can both explain to us what led you there to today. Amanda, you grew up in Bethlehem. What leads you here today in Geneva?
Thank you. First of all, it's an honor to be here and to be able to give the voice of Palestinian women to you. And I hope that I can be resourceful and be able to send the image of what Palestinian women are doing now and their belief in a nonviolent solution for what's happening in the region. I grew up in a Christian family in Palestine, in a small town of Beit Jala in Palestine. And I was, this, I mean, what movie we saw now, I had information about the first intifada, but I was only 1 year old when it happened. I was born in 1989. And it was inspiring to see actually that the women, that time I knew that, but to see the personal stories of the women was inspiring, and also that there was a role from the Israeli women in solidarity with the Palestinian women is really important. So for me, I come from, I'm a psychologist, a therapist, and an expressive arts therapist. I witnessed the second intifada. I was a teenager, and we had 40 days of invasion in the times of the second intifada, which was the second intifada was very it was very violent. We had bombardment. It was my house was partly bombarded. We were inside the house, and I lived in a neighborhood which was just next to the settlement, and it was a very difficult experience, and to see the result of the violent action, it did not make sense to respond in violent as well. So I tried to also understand the psychology of why this is happening, and the question of why led me to my studies of psychology and understanding of the trauma of both nations, and how it has affected the conflict. And this is became part of my passion and who I am, and my endless seeking for peace and human rights.
Thank you very much.
I have one.
Angela.
Okay, so maybe first I'll do something symbolic, because I believe in symbolism, and I will put on my t-shirt and it will give me power. And on the t-shirt it says in three languages, women wage peace. In Hebrew we call the movement Nashim Osot Shalom, women make peace. And in Arabic, Amanda will correct my Arabic. Will you say it, please, for me?
Yasnan as-salam.
Okay. So we say, we have the three languages on our t-shirts. I have to put it on.
No, it's fine.
Bravo. Okay. Turquoise et blanc, turquoise and white, it's
white. Symbol. It's a symbol, although in the Arab world, white is a sign of mourning, but it's a color that we have chosen to wear. An official, I don't wear white all the time. I wear white on official events. This is my uniform, white and turquoise, which is a color of hope. Also in Arab, in Egyptian cultures, apparently it is a strong color and it brings good energies and good vibes and good karma. So you see, I've got lots of turquoise on me. I wanted to say a few words about my past. Maybe you'll understand my connection, how I connected to this movement. I was born in Switzerland many years ago. I grew up in Switzerland, in the German-speaking part of Switzerland. And experienced a lot of feeling of alienation, not belonging, not being a part of society, not having a family, a big family here. My parents, my mother's a Holocaust survivor. My father was in the British Army, and he also took care of the displaced people after the war. So they were both people who had experienced a certain big trauma in their lives. And I think I carried this with me, and we all carry some kind of traumas with us. And even if there was no talk about it, it was part of my being. And also I maybe experienced some unpleasantness of being Jewish. I was always the only Jewish girl in a school, with never surrounded by other Jewish children. And often I heard words like, we're not in a Jewish school here. It was not a pleasant feeling to be Jewish in Switzerland, even in the 60s. Which brought me to the decision to come to Israel, which I felt was my home, and I still feel it is my home, and I'm very pleased and happy, and I feel 100% clear with myself that it was a good, right decision for me to build my life as an adult in Israel. I have my children, my grandchildren already, so we're already three generations in one country, which we didn't do in any other place. said this, this will now lead me to my connection to Women Wage Peace and to my activism. I think I grew up in a house with awareness, social rights, human rights. There was always talk about it, and I think that I fed on it, I heard it. It was my father's mission that there is injustice, and injustice has to be addressed. Mm-hmm. And I live in a kibbutz, which is so-called a social community, which obviously has tried to eliminate injustice and unsocial events. It's like, you know, making everybody equal, which is also only an illusion because there's no such thing as equality. But I think that all these statements are important to understand why at the end of my day, and I've always been this way, it's not new, I joined Women Wage Peace 3 years ago, but I've always been active in some kind. It was Shalom Achshav, Peace Now, for women, for mothers, which was a movement which was very implementary for the end of the Israeli occupation for the IDF in Lebanon. So it was always a part of my being. But now, since I'm already at a certain age, I feel there's time to leave something for the next generation. I feel it's my mission. I have the time, I have the energy to do something in order to change the reality. And as said in the movie, and also I think we heard it in the first movie by the women, by the Naila's uprising. It is my duty, I feel it is my obligation to make sure that for the next generation or the generation that will come after, and we had the Palestinian woman who said exactly the same thing, that it is our duty and our role to make sure for the next generation to live in a better world. And this sounds banal, it sounds naive, but this is the drive. So this is the beginning.
Thank you very much. I have many questions. I'm sure we won't have the time to get them all, but one thing seems very important to settle this discussion is that Women Wage for Peace is apolitical. It's apolitical, an alpha privatif, it's non-political, but asks for political solutions. So it's a movement to make pressure on the politicals to finally hear women's voices. Can you explain to us why is that important?
I think one of our roles, and we're an inclusive movement. We're a grassroots movement, civil society movement, and we don't have anything, you know, anything real. We don't have any sanctions. If anybody has seen the movie about the Liberian, which Abigail Disney, who was the same producer of the movie we just saw, she was a producer of a movie called Pray the Good Devil Back to Hell. If you've seen it, there's a sentence that a woman says, you know, they advocate for a sex strike. Okay, that's a sort of a weapon which was used in ancient Greece, Palizistrata, and they suggest it. But we realize that there's no way, the pressure is not something we can really, we don't have a tool. We don't have anything really, you know, we don't want to take off our clothes and lie in front of the Knesset or chain ourselves to the Knesset. Because also one of our principles that we do not use, we're not violent and we don't act against the law, which is an important principle for us because it's like a guideline. So the way we can really put pressure, or not pressure, but the way we can influence our leaders is by our presence. So what we're trying to do is to increase our presence, to be more and more and more and more and more people that we cannot be ignored, that we will not, in 2016, when we had the end of the march in Jerusalem, we stood in front of the Benjamin Netanyahu's residence in Jerusalem. There was a black curtain which sort of separated between us and his residency, his home. That was like a sign telling us, we're not interested, we don't want to hear. So what we did next time, we didn't go there again. What we went, we chose a public place, a big park within Jerusalem, which you just saw when Huda spoke. And there was place for everybody, and there was no feeling of we don't want to be heard, and we were covered by more media, more media, more media. I'm not saying, I don't want to give the impression that we are worldwide known movement. I don't know how many people who've been in this in this hall really heard about us, but this is the way, this is our drive, and we want to act this way. And we go, maybe I can give a small example. We go to the Knesset, which is the Israeli parliament, every Monday. And it's not one person, we're 50, 60. People travel from where I live in the northern, I live in the south of Lebanon, which is the northern border of Israel. And people come from Eilat, which is, I mean, Israel is small, but all the same, it's a big effort. And we come to the Knesset on Mondays, which is a day where they have open sessions and they have committees, and we're invited to the committees. And members of parliament of all straits, even Yehuda Glick, who is like the most right representative, come and they talk to us and they hear us and they encourage us to come again and again and again. So I think our influence is, it's like little points of light or little like sowing seeds somewhere. And it's not going to immediately, it's not seen immediately. 3 years is a short time for a social civil society to be felt. And it is not a resistance movement. We are nonviolent civil society. We're not a nonviolent resistant movement. It is it's a total difference. We don't resist, but we act in favor of our beliefs and our aim, our goals. I think I've said enough.
Amanda, you yes. participated to last year's march, and for you, there is a strong meaning in sisterhood beyond borders. How do you see that importance? What does this sisterhood beyond borders import to you and the Palestinian women?
For me, I come from a humanistic and universal approach of human suffering. And I believe it's the efforts of the women who are not just sisterhood, it's actually humanity, you know. Beyond the nationality, we work for a purpose of achieving the freedom of the people who are oppressed, of you know, the human rights to be achieved, to have the freedom of deciding the destiny, of deciding to choose peace, also to have the freedom for the Palestinians to choose peace. Because as Julia has said a lot about the constraints of even participating in such occasions are limited. In the march, there were many women from Gaza who were supportive of the march, but they could only send messages, they could only send letters, they could not come to the places in Jerusalem. I was participating in the march, but it was two sides. It was in the Dead Sea, and the other, I mean, it continued till Jerusalem and it grew bigger. And I could not go to the one in Jerusalem, even if I wanted, because of the limitations of movement. And at that time, I did not had a permit to join.
That's one of the problems. It's one of the obstacles you have. It's two populations, women from both sides, but that cannot. It's asymmetrical. Palestinian women have less ways to come to these marches.
You want me to answer?
Yes.
Okay. I think, you know, Amanda said it, and I'll say it again. Women Wage Peace is an Israeli movement which works in association with several Palestinian women's movements. There's, and I can tell you the names, there's Alep and Shuru, Huda Abu Karub, who you saw in the short film, and there's Tahrir, and there's Roots, and there's Rabbi Schlesinger, who is for Rabbis for Peace. I mean, there's lots of movements, and each movement has its own agenda, and each movement has its own voice, and it has its own goals and aims. Like the Palestinian women's movement also has to take care of its own position within the Palestinian society. Whereas the Israeli women's movement, I mean, I don't say we're liberated, but maybe in comparison to Palestinian women, we are. We're not restricted by movement, and it's a democratic country, and we have rights. There's right of speech and right of everything. Even sometimes, maybe from as an outsider, it seems it is not, but there it is a democratic society. And so we have to cope with other things. But I think that I can give you an example, which just happened on the 8th of March, which was the International Women's Day. And it was celebrated together with Palestinian women and Women Wage Peace and other movements in other Israeli movements under the auspice of the United Nations resolution, which is 1325, which also Julia mentioned. She didn't give the number, but it's a resolution which we also very firmly believe in. 1325 says, in other words, that there should be the same representation of women in the conflict resolution process as they are in the population. We heard it by an Arab lady. She said it directly. She didn't call it. She just knew it, and it's true. And that's what we believe in this. So this event that was organized on last Thursday, on the 8th of March, 3 days ago, 4 days ago, was a joint venture. So when we can, in Jerusalem, in front of the wall, it was in front of Damascus Gate, there was an event going, starting the year, which the whole year will be like dedicated or in the sign, under the sign of this resolution. And at the end, there will be a march. The plan is to march from Bethlehem, Bejala, to Jerusalem. So I hope we can join.
We hope that for you too.
I mean, that we can both march together.
What women in this conflict, where there is an everyday violence, where there are people who die, people in jail, what's the particular price that women pay in this conflict?
I believe women pay the highest price, as always in wars. And it's the highest price of, you know, oppression under any kind of violence that is happening. And the highest price is when you send your child to war, and losing that child and losing your children due to the war, due to the conflict. And I feel really bad for the Israeli society that the going to the army is an obligation, and all children have to go to the army and participate. So it's very difficult. And I know many Israeli women who refuse to send their children to the army, but then they have to serve in prison.
There is a high price for that.
I think Israel is the situation, the climate in Israel today, after 50 years of being under subduing another people, has had effects, psychological effects on the people, effects on people's soul, on everything. I mean, the fact that we are paranoid people, I must say. It's not something, it doesn't sound normal, but it is. We are paranoid people. We survived the Holocaust, hardly, somehow got out of these ashes of the Holocaust. And then we were convinced that the right thing was to create our own state, which is maybe the right solution for Israel, not being aware that it was on the count of somebody else, of another people, which hadn't formed a personal identity yet, because it was a tribal society. And it had been surrounded by other colonial countries, which sort of started dividing the land. So knowing all this makes it difficult. And I think there's 50 years of this situation of the conflict, of unresolved conflict. And people, children that were born in this situation don't know anything else. This is the reality they know. So to change this concept that life could be different, that there is a partner, that there is we can choose a different way, we can change the narrative of the two peoples. It's a question of changing the narrative, telling another story. But it's difficult when you're paranoid. It's like you want to fight, you're being attacked, you're going to defend yourself. You must say something about that. It's fight and flight, because when you get attacked, the normal reaction is to defend yourself. Everybody knows that. I mean, we experience that on a personal level too. So I think Israel, you can put that way. Israel is in a way, you know, always under the feeling it has to defend itself. And every time it sort of felt that it wanted to trust, and then there was another blow, you know, it wasn't really, you know, they weren't, because the trust, we just saw the trust was maybe not built on mutual trust. So Women Wage Peace have made it very clear, one of our aims is to that the agreement, when it will be reached, it cannot be agreement imposed by one side. It cannot be like when Ariel Sharon decided to retreat from Gaza and just locked off, you know, went back and locked off the side and didn't ask the Gazans what they wanted, what they needed. It was just a one-sided solution. So it's very clear to Women Wage Peace that the only thing that will be acceptable is an acceptable agreement which has been made together and which is acceptable by both sides, both parties, and not one-sided, because the situation is not symmetrical, as Amanda mentioned.
You talked about trauma. We know that on someone who has been traumatized on a person, when this person then has a stress or an event, traumatic event, the person will react badly. Mm-hmm. Can we say it's the same for a whole population that has lived so many traumas, then is stressed, and how do we heal these kind of collective wounds?
Thank you for asking this question. That's exactly related to my work, because yes, we can say that it's not in Palestine, I mean, it's not a PTSD. It's a collective, accumulative trauma that is happening on a daily basis for the Palestinians. And to heal it, you can do damage control, you know? And what I work in is promoting resilience, which is promoting resilience and finding hope and self-reflection and self-development under all the situations that's happening. Because there was a question like, with the High Commissioner, like, where do you go when you don't find a leadership or someone to go to when the situation is very bad? And I teach people to go inside, because that's what I did. When outside there was no one to go to, I went inside. And inside of myself. And that's what I hope to inspire people who have the trauma in Palestine to go inside and have the hope from inside, have the resilience and the confidence. And that's what's, you see, if you look at the Palestinian youth, and I'm one of them, we see the world and we want to take part of it. We want to have normal life, normal jobs. We want to be part of the technology. If you go to Ramallah or Bethlehem, you will see the Palestinian youth, especially. That's where I get my inspiration from. That they really want to have a good life, and they
go to school, university. Yes, they try to get education.
Yes, education is the number one priority in Palestinian society, and that's one part of the nonviolent and peaceful approach. And that's what the women play a role in sending making sure that the children go to school. And as I was telling you, in my city in Bethlehem, the university, 77% of the students is females. It's a very high number. So, and also the highest marks are always taken by women.
Well done. Great. Women power.
Yeah. Maybe a word
about
this trauma question, the whole population that has.
First of all, I'm not a psychologist, so this is the expert, not me. But I feel very close to what Amanda says, and I think one of the tools that we use is listening. We call it radical listening. You've ever heard of this? Radical listening. So there is a word we use in the Women Wage Peace, which is radical. And what we mean is when we really listen, I heard a very beautiful story, and I've said it already 2 days ago. I'm going to repeat it. It's for 9 months, we are carried in our mother's wombs, and we just listen. We don't talk, we just listen. For 9 months, which is a long period of our lives, and we listen because we know that the children that embryos hear and unborn children hear, if they are not deaf, of course. And after that, we lose this ability. We don't have it anymore. What we usually do is want to voice our ideas, talk, preach, discuss, and not really listening. So I was in this experience a few days ago when I was screening the movie, movie I mentioned before, which Abigail Disney produced, the Pray the Devil Back to Hell. And at the end also there was like, there's usually the screening of the movie, and at the end there's a crowd and we talk and we discuss and we ask the people what they took from the movie and how they felt about the movie. And what we did also was like practicing this radical listening, which means that when every person talks, the other person does not interfere, because we live today in a society where there's absolutely no, the concentration span is very low, and the ability to listen to somebody else is nearly zero, because what I have to say it now, immediately. So that's one way of, one tool, I think, which is, I like the image of the 9 months. So if we can wait for 9 months, we can wait for a few more minutes and listen. And I think we do that. I think we, today, like, I haven't met Amanda before. Amanda and me, we met in Geneva, first time, the city of human rights. And which it was a very emotional meeting, and I think it was strong. And I also, one of the things I have experienced through Women WHP is that I've come closer to the Palestinian population. I was just speaking about things without really knowing them. So it's a human connection, which is the most important way of building bridges and creating a better a chance for the future of our lives. Not just, maybe it's not for now, it's for later on. So we had this this ride, and we were fortunate enough to get to know each other, and it was it's a very good experience, and it's I think we've created some kind of bond already, which will last.
And these bonds, these bridges you build, what's the reception of both sides, Palestinian and Israeli populations? How does this movement is perceived by Israelis and Palestinians?
I'll do it short. I mean, we're perceived by many people. Like when my friends know I'm Women Wage Peace, and they say, "What do you talk about?" The first reaction is, "There's no partner." Those who say that they don't believe in peace will say immediately, "There's no partner." And I've learned that you don't have to reply to everything. Okay, you believe there's no partner. I've found partners. And if I found one partner, another partner, and they found me too, so there obviously are some partners. Maybe there's not enough yet, but we will make sure that there will be more. So I think it's a movement of women. We don't exclude men, but just we believe that women, when men are around, they sort of dominate the discourse and the talk. So we prefer that to keep it run. It's run by women, but it's open to men. So if any men here want to join, you're welcome. But I think we're a small part. I mean, what is 30,000? What are 40,000? Maybe we've got on Facebook, we have a few million likes for a song or something, but it doesn't really mean that everybody who pressed like is a real supporter. So there is still cynicism about our movement, but we...
Amanda, when you participated to the march, what...
For us as Palestinian women, we also search for a partner, because obviously the system, the Israeli government, has failed as a partner in the peace talk. And for the Palestinians, many have questions regarding Women Wage Peace as an Israeli organization, because of the disappointments they had earlier in peace talk, and it has been terrible. People have lost hope, simply. So it doesn't make sense for many people now to participate or be engaged in.
Continue. Yeah. It's not easier with all the
dissent. Yes. Yeah. So we need to set an example and give some results in order to revive the hope for the Palestinians to believe again that it can be possible. And we have and Women Wage Peace is an example that there's a partner, there's someone who's there in the Palestinian, in the Israeli society, that is for human rights.
Thank you very much. On me fait signe donc lors des questions.
Okay, I've been instructed to take questions from the audience now. So we have 20-25 minutes. So I see hands being raised. So, yes, many, many. So we're going to start with the right side of the room, the lady in blue, and the other lady in the middle of the row, and the gentleman in the front.
Merci aux intervenants et à.
Thank you very much to the guests and the host. I'm going to speak in French because I feel better speaking French than English. I would like to say to this Palestinian lady, as having worked in Palestine as a therapist, I say every woman is traumatized. It was a game session with a group I worked in the West Bank and Ramallah, and I went on the side of the participants, and after a while they made me confidences, and they told me, we are all traumatized. They are afraid when the children play, because when they do as they are playing war, a soldier may think that they are shooting. So there are no playgrounds, and we are afraid and scared every time somebody of the family goes out. And this gives rise to domestic violence and the helicopters turning above the heads every night in Hebron. This whole atmosphere is terrible. But I would like to say there is an occupier and there is a people being occupied. I am not for violence, but you have to give Caesar back. To Caesar back what he owes. When you say that Israel is a democratic city, I do not agree because the Palestinians do not have the same rights that the Israelis. And I always said that the government of Netanyahu is a criminal government because he sends his youth fighting against the Palestinians. I have also people on the Jewish side who is working with the newcomers from Ethiopia and Russia. Those children are sent to war, and then they feel bad, they are traumatized. So these Israelis are also scared for their own children. Maybe this Israeli society could also do something, because every time they just move, there is repression by the army and by the government. Of course, I support all the movements in Palestine and Israel, but I think you have not to forget that there is one occupier and people being Madame occupied. Thank you very much. While we are giving the microphones, would you like to react?
Wait for the second. Yes. Absolutely, you are right. It's a totally different situation because we are not two countries in war. We have, definitely, we are an occupier, an occupied country. And the power is not symmetrical. It's not at all. Absolutely. But what was her question?
It was more testimony, a way of saying what she saw on the on the field.
Yes, that's very true.
Yeah,
very true. And the solution has to eliminate these problems, has to find result for the Palestinian people, because I mean, when women work on such issues, it has to be, you know, something that includes definitely at the first. It's the first thing. It's the first level to take care of is the human rights of the Palestinians, and that's what many of my Israeli women here, they believe in that it should be the priority.
I will also react to ladies. Declaration. I think I have to separate. I'm here as a representative of Women Wage Peace, and as Women Wage Peace, we are a movement that believes that only by ending the conflict, and we call it the conflict because it is a conflict between two sides. Only by ending it will we ensure that there will be the human rights will be respected at their full, entirely. As long as the conflict has not been resolved, Because there have been so many different attempts of achieving, trying to stop the conflict and trying to solve it. And there's been Madrid, and there's been Geneva, and there's been Oslo, and there's been two states, one homeland. I mean, there's many, many different approaches, and none of them have brought any success for various reasons, which we have discussed here now before, speaking about different traumas and being paranoid and all that. But I think our aim and our purpose is just to say that the faster that we have to do it fast. We can't go on in this situation for a long, long time, because the prices that everybody's paying, we are paying a high price. The Israeli society is traumatized. The Palestinian society is traumatized. And I'm not judging, because one of the things that I've learned, that we've learned, is to stop this attitude of blaming and shaming. There's one person has to be blamed and the other one has to be shamed. And looking for the guilty, it is to end the situation as quick as possible.
Thank you. Alors, Madame, Monsieur Devant, je
okay, the lady, the gentleman, I see hands up. Écoute, Madame.
Moi, je peux parler en français.
Oui,
en
oui, fait. C'est traduit. Elle entend la traduction.
Yes, there's a translation.
Bon, à propos
so,
de ce que
you know,
vient de dire Madame.
Regarding what Madame just said, I understand full well what you're saying, but there are exceptions. For instance, in an Israeli hospital, the director is an Arab, Israeli, Palestinian. So there are exceptions. Now, I'd like to ask. It's very important where the person is speaking from. Angela, do you still live in the kibbutz in the northern part of the country, or do you live in Zurich? So are you living in Zurich, or are you living still in the kibbutz? So I said I was living in the Baham kibbutz. Yes, I wanted to make things absolutely clear. Thank you.
Monsieur Devant.
The gentleman in the front row.
Merci.
Thank you.
Bonsoir.
Good evening.
The fact that Netanyahu
is a criminal is obvious, because, you know, the courts of his, he's being prosecuted by the courts of his own country. So here's my question.
So
there was one fact that was denounced on several occasions by UNICEF, and it's unacceptable, inhuman reality. We're talking about the thousands of children who are held prisoner in Israel. We don't quite know their number, because the Israel government will refuse to give you the numbers.
Last year it was 1,500 children.
Voilà, c'est ça.
That's it.
Manuel, il y a cette jeune fille de 16 ans qui est en prison.
And one also is 16 years who's been put into prison for.
C'est une situation absolument
and this is inhuman, unacceptable, especially for a democracy, because you don't throw children into prison, at least in a civilized country. I'd like to know whether a woman weighed peace expresses itself when you say women, you think mothers, children, and so what? The Israeli society. What's the position in front of such an unacceptable and barbaric situation? There are 10-year-old children, 11-year-old children who are behind the bars for unlimited sentence without having been judged. And we all know full well the trauma this can have on these children. At such a young age, I mean, they're experiencing something totally inhuman, and we don't know for how many months, how many years.
The question of human rights overall for the children's rights that are in jail, very low age.
Well, first of all, I must again repeat that I'm representing a movement. I'm not the law. I'm not the Israeli government. I'm not a representative of the Israeli government. I'm a civil society member of a civil society. And as a civil society, we have made it very clear that we are against any form of violence, physical, verbal, psychological violence. But our agenda, our aim, and the things we're concentrating on are indirectly human rights. I mean, it is a coincidence with Israel celebrating its 70th year of existence, anniversary, and this is the 70th year of the Human Rights Declaration, which was in Paris. I've done some homework too. And I believe that it is maybe because we are a very diverse society, and within Israel there are people who object to certain ways of talking and presenting and talking about Israel in a negative way. And there's no way you will bring me, make me talk about Israel, you know, accuse Israel for anything at this moment. If you want to talk to me about it on a personal level, I will be welcome to speak to you when we leave the stage, because this is not in my mandate to do so. But I again will repeat and will say our aim, the only way we believe we can end this situation is by ending the conflict and by finding a feasible, endurable, acceptable, respectable, jointly created and formed agreement between the two sides, which are the Palestinians and the Israelis. Not the way it was done, you know, by one side. I've said it again, so I regret that I cannot say more than that on this issue. I don't understand this issue. I'm not a legal, I'm not a person who understands, I don't have a legal formation. Obviously, as a person, I feel it's unbelievable, it shouldn't happen, but it is not in my mandate to talk about it. I'm sorry.
Merci pour votre réponse. Je tiens à préciser
thank you for your answer, and we're very lucky to have two representatives of civil society who are, you know, fighting day in, day out to bring about peace. And it is true, they are not here representing the Israeli government, or they're not here, you know, representing, you know, a feminist movement. So I wanted to thank you both for being here. I saw one hand raised. Yes, madam. Another one,
et Madame ici.
And the
je
lady
pense
here.
Que trois questions, voilà,
okay, we'll take the three questions.
Donc, hello, voilà, yes. Vous avez le micro. On vous écoute.
I have two questions. One is, what kind of advocacy do you do with the communities in the settlements? If you're looking for a conflict, maybe this is one major obstacle, I think. I don't think this is very political, it's just a fact. So do you try to reach out to the communities in the settlements to try to gain some of new members for your movement? And the second one is, you mentioned, you made a distinction earlier that you are acting for a certain purpose, and you made a distinction that you are not peaceful resistance. But peaceful resistance is also nonviolent. So why do you make this distinction? And what do you have against actions of peaceful resistance?
The first part of your question, who was spoken with to me? Who, what's your name? Who?
I'm Nadia Shati. I'm of Syrian origin, Swiss, okay. Since 30 years, and I okay. live in Zurich.
I live in a contradictional society, in a contradictional situation. Thank you for telling me your identity. On one hand, I'm surrounded by countries which want my distinction, my extermination, and it's a paranoid way of thinking, looking at reality, but it has been repeated several times. On the other hand, we feel empathetic with the Syrian civil society and civilians who have been undergoing terrible suffering. And I can just give an example, and that's why I'm saying we're a contradictory society, because on one hand we reach our hand for humanitarian aid, which is maybe the easiest thing to do, by giving medical aid, by letting them come into Israel to the hospitals and getting medical treatment. I don't, maybe you've heard of this, you haven't heard of it, but it is like quite a contradictory situation between two countries which are officially still at war. That's one thing. And the other thing I would like to tell you about our policy of women, wage, peace, we reach out. That one of our aims is to be diverse. Israel is a very polarized society. There's Tel Aviv, left wing, well-educated, higher level social status, and all the rest of the country. Lots of religious people. There's the new arisal of religion in the country, like everywhere else in the world. And, well, anyway, in this world, maybe not in Europe. And our aim is not to just remain elitistic, because elitism is something that usually is associated with left-wing groups, which reach out for just speak about human rights, just speak about them. And so we have two jobs. We have a lot of jobs. We have to also reach out, find partners within Israel, among Israeli women, people who don't object. For them, it's a new language. They don't know this language. They've been living for 50 years under a different sound. So we have that, and we have the settlers you talked about, and we have people in the settlements. Michal Forman, you saw in the short clip, she lives in Tkoa, which is a settlement. She's the sister. What do you call it?
Rabbi.
No. She's the rabbi was her father-in-law, the rabbi who died, Forman. He was a man of peace also. But they live in the settlements, and they're ready to remain there. There are rabbis amongst them who would want to stay there, would be ready to stay there even if it would become Palestine. For them, the meaning of belonging and living there is more important than being an Israeli in their own state. But that's an exception again. But we are reaching out. There are people. It's not a majority. The majority of the women wage peace are people that resemble me more than they resemble other people. I must admit that. But we say it and we mean it, and we have we invest a lot of energy in trying to reach out and bringing other voices. Because if we don't solve the conflict within ourselves, how will we be able to solve it with others, with our neighbors, with our not enemies? I don't want to call Amanda an enemy because she's not. But I cannot. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's one thing. And the second thing was?
Was you made a distinction between what you are doing, your actions, and peaceful resistance.
Okay. Now, because I was had this discussion with Julia, who's left, and I said, Julia Basha, she was sort of, not excusing me, but saying, you know, why are you against resistance? I mean, a real activist has to resist. And I say it's maybe true, maybe a real activist. There are resistant movements. I'm not against resistance, but Women Wage Peace hasn't chosen this way. We've chosen another way, which I've said has to coincide with law. And even peaceful resistance usually goes against the law. It doesn't. It's not violent, but it is resistant. So for the time being, but we reinvent ourselves every few months. So maybe if the situation will change and will demand, maybe we'll have to change our strategy. But it is a movement which doesn't stick, you know, to one dogma only. But although so far we have, but who knows? Maybe there will be need. I hope there won't be to resist.
It kind of made me think to the Argentina with the mothers who fighted for their lost children, who tried to make something within the law. So it was just standing there. And just standing there was already something quite strong for the society at this moment. So I guess also you're fighting with a context, a situation that is so tensed and so difficult, that so complex. Maybe also people have to think about in which situation you are, and that even just march with women from all these situations, all these origins, is already a sign, a strong sign, a strong symbol.
I don't want to take over. Maybe Amanda, you want to say something?
Je ne veux pas monopoliser la parole, Amanda. Je ne sais pas si vous voulez vous exprimer.
C'est
bon. Moi, je représente un peu l'occupant, pas facile.
I think there's no symmetry, and even the comparison now with the. I mean, there's movements. We had a movement in Israel, I mentioned before, Four Mothers, which was a movement which really was so effective. They just stood there every day, I think once, for weeks ahead, in front of the Ministry of Defense, at crossword, in front of the Knesset. And they put so much pressure on the ministry, on the defense minister, that the end of their, that was, I don't know if you would call it resistance, but it was activism. Israel retreated from South Lebanon, the IDF. Told out his forces, and they had it. They achieved. But times have changed. You can't always. And we have people from that movement. They're four women, and they are part of our movement too. And what was right in 2000 is not right in 2017. The situation is not the same, and it is changing constantly. So, and what was right in Argentina, which I know it was right for Argentina at that time. Maybe we are a we don't have. There's no threats on my life, whereas maybe there are threats on Amanda's. So my activities are within law, and I can do whatever I want. I mean, we can do. We need a permit from the police to march, and when we stand, but there are things. But we, within the framework of the law, we can. We have a lot of freedom.
Thank you.
And Amanda. What we hope from the organization is that it can able to bring back some conscience into the minds of the Israeli youth, and so that some action can happen, some change can happen, and they can influence the government. And we, I mean, it is a civil society movement, but we understand that the solution has to be political. It has to be on the ground reality. There has to be freedom. There has to be, the Palestinians have to have the right to decide for themselves, the right to decide for their destiny. Then we can have, the basic needs have to be also guaranteed for the Palestinian people, especially water, electricity. We are talking basics. Then we can afford the luxury of speaking about other things.
Thank you, Amanda. Thank you very much. There are two last questions. We have 5 minutes. So first, in these ranks, no? No one? So, okay, madame, and that will be the last question, then we listen to you.
Great, thank you. Sophia, I work on human rights, health as a human right. Thank you so much for the civil society perspective from the ground. That's rare. I think it's incredible that we have this. So what would you like the international community to hear, the voice from the ground? And what can we do, what things can we do to enable women wage peace so that we are steering away from the kind of good versus bad dichotomy that we often put onto one society or one perspective or one narrative? So what can we do to enable peace on the international level and at the political level? And then secondly, maybe tapping Amanda on your psychology background, how do we actively engage, and you had mentioned radical listening as one, how do we actively engage people who are not convinced, who are very set on perhaps demonizing one side and martyring another, for example?
Who first?
What can we do?
You have 5 minutes.
Okay. I lost my. Thank you very much for your, the insight. It's interesting to hear something so complex. The international community, I think our call, and we reached out from the very beginning. We have ambassadors, we have people, and Massia and Mira, and there are grassroots organizations and other foundations which support us even financially, because everything is voluntarily. I'm coming here. I was fortunate enough to be invited very generously by
the festival,
which is, I mean, everywhere we go, and the time that I'm here, there's two things, events happening. There's the JCall, the IPAC in America, and there's the JCall coming up in New York also, and there's J Street, this is JCall here, and there's something happening in Belgium, and there's also something happening somewhere else. I can't remember. I'm just telling you, it's like the world is spinning around, and we're being courted. It's never enough. But the fact that we've realized that our power is not, or our influence, not power is a bad word, is on an international basis just as well as on a local one, and that we're getting support, even only just moral support, mails, invitations. Tomorrow, we are trying to get the recognition of the United Nations. There's a status which is called, I wrote it down, I'll tell you in a moment, because it is important, okay? Just a second. I will find it. Here it is. Eligibility to the special consultative status by the United Nations. We've applied for it because we are a foundation. We more or less we fit into the definition. This will also give us more exposure and more influence. And our voice, we want to hear it. We want people to hear it. We want it to be resonant. We want it to be spoken out. And we want people. And we use symbols. I must say, we use symbols. The white, and the songs, and the marching. We're taking symbols from other fights. Because we believe in visuality. I mean, it's a visual world. So that's one of the things that I think that's the way the international community can continue to help and be open-minded. I think that's one of our main thing is the open-mindedness, not to just close our minds and say they're good ones, they're bad ones. Because on both sides, I mean, we all have our feelings of guilt and all. Did I answer?
Yes, Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
And I believe the international community plays a part. You are a citizen of these countries, and you can also influence your governments. And on a personal level, you can visit our country. You can be a witness. You can see what's happening. You can provide us forum to present ourselves just like this one. And support in any way you can find it possible, the efforts of the people on the ground, the civilians who are trying to do something to change something with the reality for the future. And for your other question about
the trauma,
engaging those who might be closed off to
that's a very good question, because of I mean, the despair and the fear stops people from meeting. And for the Israelis, even they are separated by the Palestinians, by the wall and other obstacles. And we have to find ways to meet beyond these obstacles. And we should give hope a chance rather than the fear of the other. And that happens when there are many Palestinians, many Israelis have never met an Israeli or a Palestinian. There are many Palestinians who have never met an Israeli civilian. All Palestinians have met only Israeli soldiers. So we have to change that. We have to find ways that we people to people can meet and have the power of the people to change the reality for the better future of our children.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Beyond fear and despair, women. Thank you very much for your intervention today. Thank you for merci au public pour ces interventions.
To thank the audience for your questions, and I'd like to thank Leo Kaneman, who has the mic in hand.
Voilà.
Well, I'd like to thank Laura, who was a fantastic moderator of this debate. I'd like to thank our two panelists, one from Palestine, Amanda, one from Israel, Angela. Thank you. I think they deserve a very, very warm round of applause. They were formidable.
Et puis j'aimerais remercier les traductrices qui ont fait un travail extraordinaire.
The interpreters, I think they also deserve an applause. Thank you very much. Je vous parle maintenant.